Also, let me tell you, this pandemic, we know that it hit our community hard and our cultural community the hardest. Howie was right there, boots on the ground, working with my administration to deploy, again, resources to our cultural community. It did not stop there. Howie understands that this city continues to be on the front lines of climate change, but also embracing and being that focal point, the city that the world looks to for innovation, for resiliency. And that showed up once again under Howie's leadership when Ida came our way, activating resources, feeding over 20,000 people in 8 days. You know, so it really goes on and on. So I know without a doubt that we have the best person in this position to bridge that gap, to be that champion of culture, but work government, again, to meet our people where they are. Culture is economy in the city of New Orleans, and you can't pick and choose on how you want to embrace, love on, and support culture, and the men and women who make it what it is, and how we as a city have to focus on preserving it, because it's everything that this city is about, and again, a world-class city, and this city is leading in the era of globalization. So let's get out of our own way and embrace culture at every single level because it matters. And culture is the economy of the city of New Orleans, but more importantly, even the state of Louisiana. So with that, I'm going to bring up my fierce leader of cultural economy, and that is Miss Lisa Alexis. Lisa?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. She's awesome. And I would like to say, Howie, the Office of Cultural Economy stands in support of our nighttime economy because we know, as the mayor has stated, culture is the economy of our city. And as people may know in my office, I like to just go through the ABCs of what we're doing. So instead of ABC, I'm going to choose O, P, and Q. O is the opportunities. The Office of Cultural Economy, over the past few years, especially during our pandemic, has stepped out to embrace the culture. We created the opportunity of doing our Embrace the Culture series, which was initiatives that went to venues that were closed at that time in a safe manner, and we paid our cultural artists to perform, to cook, to do visual arts, to do fashion, to read books, literary, as well as film industry as well took place. So I just would like to speak to the fact that we recognize and realize that our office stands in place to create the opportunities for our culture to continue to elevate and to thrive. And in doing so, just over this year, we've granted over 50-plus grants. We've granted over $150,000. And then with NOTCF, we've also granted over $3 million within our cultural economy. But then that leads me into the letter P. P is in partnership. I would like to say before Howie took this position, we already had an opportunity to partner with the Office of Cultural Economy and the Howling Wolf as we were in a pandemic and to function in a safe way. The Beignet Festival, Howie took the Beignet Festival into the Howling Wolf, and we partnered as a sponsor of the Beignet Festival. And there are so many other partnerships. There are partnerships we are currently engaged in with the French Market Corporation. We see great opportunity, not only in our Frenchman Street Corridor, but with the French Market, Waldenburg Park, Crescent Park. We also see great opportunity and partnership with our museums, City Park, partnerships just throughout the city. So I just want you to know that partnership is very key for our office, and it's very key in the nighttime economy being successful because we want to know how we may improve, how we may partner, and how we may engage with you so that our processes and our opportunities continue to grow. And then it leads me to Q. We're just not going to be quiet anymore. Right. I'm not sure if you all know right. as much opportunity and benefits there are out there that our city government is providing to our cultural economy. So we're going to make it a point to make sure that we're no longer a quiet jewel, but working with Howie and the nighttime economy, making you aware of all of the opportunities, again, that I just referenced, that are there and available, and we are here for you to continue to embrace our culture. So thank you all so much for that opportunity to share with you our office and how we stand in support. Oh, and we partner with the Downtown Development District. I'm so sorry. I have to just go back and mention, we are already, we already met with Devon. We are already working on partnerships with the Downtown Development District. We've always already had legislation passed. We've already created a Crown Park, and we're going to be working with the Downtown Development District on so many other projects, as Downtown Development District is another art center icon space for our city as well. And economic development also, we have partnered in many great projects, and we have some real keen ones that are coming in the very near future. So I'll wrap up now, but I just want you to know partnership is key, and it is currently working. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And speaking to economic development, we're going to keep it going. We're going to hear from Jeff Swartz, who is our Director of Economic Development for the City of New Orleans. Thank you, Jeff.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Lisa. I guess I'll add E to the mix. I'll focus on the economy piece. Howie, we've already had a chance to work together, but just want to formally say welcome. And as the mayor said, we definitely have the right man for the job and looking forward to working with you every step of the way. The mayor already touched on it. The creation of the Office of Nighttime Economy is something the city and its cultural economy partners have been building towards for a good long while here. It's the efforts of the mayor, backed by the council, the advocates and stakeholders, the musicians, the culture bearers, the venues, and many others who've created this office after years of work. And so this is really the culmination of that work, but it really is just the beginning. It's the day that the doors open, and now we know that that's when the real work starts to happen. It goes without saying that the New Orleans is a city where culture is world-renowned. It's an appreciable percentage of our economic base. In some estimates, it's over a fifth of our economic activity happens after 9 to 5. And we're a city where we know that culture happens in the streets, and it happens outside of offices. And so this office, as the mayor said, is really meant to be that bridge between what goes on out in businesses, out in venues that don't necessarily happen while folks have suits on like this, and is meant to be that advocate and liaison within City Hall. We know that our cultural economy has a huge economic impact in the city. Overall, I am using some of Lisa's numbers here, but overall, our cultural economy, even outside of our large festivals and events, has over $1.5 billion of economic impact in the city on an annual basis. The city's film office alone permitted over $1 billion of production activity just in Orleans Parish. Think about that, $1 billion of activity just from the film permit in the city of New Orleans. And combined, the tourism and hospitality and cultural economy industries represent over 75,000 jobs of the almost 200,000 jobs in the city of New Orleans. So this is big business. This is about the economy of the city. It's about growing the diversity and the vibrancy of our city. And so I couldn't be more excited about doing this work with you, Howie. We also know that tourism and hospitality and the cultural economy bore the brunt of COVID, as the mayor was saying. Thousands of jobs still need to be regained in those industries, and we want to do that in a way that pays fair wages, that creates quality of life in our communities, and that really builds the base for growing for years to come. We supported, through the Office of Economic Development, work that Howie pioneered at the federal level with the Shuttered Venue Grants. We actually worked with some partners, and we actually touched every single music venue in the city to make sure everybody knew that the Shuttered Venue Grants opportunity was available. And we also worked really closely with our restaurants and bars to advocate around the Restaurant Revitalization Fund, which to this day has not been fully funded. And we continue to do that advocacy work. And so I think it's really important to note that the Office of Nighttime Economy really exists at the intersection of all of these industries. And given that a significant amount of this activity happens outside of normal business hours, whether it's our legendary bars and restaurants, a show at our world-renowned venue, or a street performer who we know is making his livelihood and actually living the organic culture of the city, this office is going to be a liaison and an advocate for every one of them. And so I'll close by saying that the Office of Nighttime Economy could not be coming online at a more opportune time. This office will work internally as a coordinator with all of our offices, with the mayor, and then externally with stakeholders and all of the different advocates and organizations and businesses that we know. There's a whole constellation of you out there that Howie probably already knows about 80% of you, and the remaining 20%, I know he's already knocking on your door. So I'm looking forward on behalf of the Office of Economic Development and the administration to rolling up my sleeves with Howie in the Office of Nighttime Economy to work to support our venues, our musicians, our culture bearers, and our communities as we increase the vibrancy of our nighttime economy in a way that works for everybody. Thank you.
So without further ado, we're going to hear from our fierce leader, We'll hear from Howie, and then we'll also hear from our partner, Mr. Devon Barber with the DDD. Howie.
Wow, where do you start with that, huh? I want to thank everybody that's kind of made this day come possible. This started about 8 or 9 years ago. Jan Ramsey wrote a fantastic article about recognizing where our cultural economy goes and how we can make investments into it and how it needs to interact with the way the city works and the way that the cultural economy as a whole works. Everybody has been a part of this, including past councils. The mayor has been a leader on this for years and years, talking about and recognizing that this is where we go. This is how we become that world-class city that we know we are. This is how we make investments into our future, make investments into the cultural economy as a whole and our culture bears. There is no city in the world like New Orleans. And you can ask any city right now, including places like Nashville and Memphis and Austin. They are not the music cities. New Orleans is. And our cultural economy as a whole isn't just that music. It's food, it's restaurants, it's bars, it's sous chefs, it's everybody here. It's the reason why everybody wants to come to New Orleans. It's a part of our soul, it's a part of our heart. But now what we get to do is we get to become a liaison between that cultural economy, those culture bearers in the city, that we get to be a fierce and vocal advocate for people that are doing this every day. Over 50,000 people are in the hospitality industry in the city of New Orleans. They are your neighbors. This isn't about an us versus them. This is all of us together raising the level of what we do. And I can't even begin to fathom like where this is gonna be and where it's gonna go over the next year, because the amount and level of support has been breathtaking. The kind words of the mayor and Lisa and Jeff, I can't wait to get to work and do what we can to help raise up that level, bring those dollars in. This is about money, but it's also about quality of life. It's also about all the people that do this every day. It's the reason we live here. Thank you very much, Madam Mayor.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everybody that's put this together, and I can't wait to listen and to talk to each and every one of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Howie. Thank you. And without further ado, I definitely want to ask Mr. Devon to come on up, a real partner with the city of New Orleans. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This is so exciting as a newcomer to this community. I was thrilled to learn of the creation of the Office of Nighttime Economy. I'm an economic developer by practitioner, and so every single day I think about creating jobs, growing our tax base, and strengthening the economy. And you know, all too often, sometimes we think of our cultural economy as a second-class citizen, but that's not the case for New Orleans. This is a world-class community. We know what people think about our community. People travel thousands of miles to spend time here. They love the music, they love the food and the culture. And so managing a downtown environment, you know, we serve residents, workers, as well as visitors. Sometimes there's a clash in the needs of these different groups. And so we really have to work very hard with these groups to ensure that we're providing this high quality service. And certainly, you know, culture and entertainment is vital to that. I can tell you that a company looking to locate to a community, they're thinking about the cultural offerings in that community. There's a book that I love called For the Rise of the Creative Class. And it's all about this notion that those cities that offer high quality of life, cultural amenities, places for residents to be engaged in the community, those will be the cities that win in the end. Those will be the cities that attract industry, that attract young professionals. And, you know, working with my colleagues behind me, I am so excited about growing the economy here. You've heard a couple of key themes: quality of life, vibrancy, world-class city. That's New Orleans. And certainly, you know, with our nighttime economy, we should not run from it. We should fully embrace it and celebrate this opportunity. So I want to thank you all again. And Howie, Downtown Development District looks forward to working with you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And listen, I know we have our world renowned bam. Kermit,
how you doing, Ms.
You got something to say?
I don't have too much to say, but I just think
come on up and say something.
This is one of the best ideas, and I always think about the kids that's going to grow up into this, and they are so blessed because we have so many young kids playing music right now in this city. You wouldn't even believe that the young kids that can stand next to me and outplay me on any stage at any given time. So they're a blessing. It's going to be real good for the future.
Absolutely.
That's for sure.
Absolutely.
Thank y'all for having me too, man.
No, and then, Carmen, you hit it on. This is about the future of the city of New Orleans. So it's about preservation. But we got to love on those who are the culture now in order to preserve it and to grow it. Absolutely. So thank you. Embrace the culture, please.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. When there are bad actors and things of that nature, can this office and how we as the head of this office affect change in that regard?
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely, and thank you for the question. While this is not an arm of enforcement, it is about bridging the gap. It is about listening. It is about gaining a real understanding of what is happening on the ground that will then influence enforcement from the enforcement arm of city government so that it's balanced, so that it's fair, and that's, I believe, is what our businesses, as well as our musicians, our cultural bears really want. They want fairness. They want looking through that lens of equity and inclusion. And so Howie will be that arm on the ground, but will definitely influence enforcement in other aspects and get us to where we need to be. You know, there was a big dust up several years ago with the noise ordinance relative to our musicians, right? But Howie being in this position can bridge that gap, have a greater understanding of what the issues are and not have it overshadowed by noise, but really by what the real needs are. And then for us to be able to meet those needs, again, looking through the ends of equity, inclusion, fairness, and that's what it's about. And Howie, you the director, so if you want to add something, please do.
Well, actually, I kind of do.
Yeah, good.
To kind of answer your question, is it an enforcement arm? No, we're not code enforcement. We're not safety and permits. But what we can do is provide guidance, education, compliance. 99% of the people that are out there are doing it right. Let's give them the opportunity to do it right. And those that aren't, that's when we start leaning in. That's when we start using those resources and recognizing that the bad actors make the good actors have to work harder.
All right, so last question. I don't think anyone told a mistruth about Howie and the work he's done here. I've had my experience covering this stuff. You can't find him directly in this office more connected. However, and this is another side of that, for folks that would say, but he is a business owner of a business that will be under the purview of this law.
Sure.
Is there a conflict of interest?
Sure. So, no. Bottom line is we've dealt with this head on. The ethics review and making sure that we had opinions that was factored into this process. Also steps that Howie has taken to ensure that, one, he's in full compliance. No conflict of interest exists there. Howie, you want to share about some of those steps you've taken in terms of your ownership and the like?
And so we are still waiting, and we will have an opinion from the State Ethics Board. And so we're still finishing up the paperwork to make certain that we are in compliance. But understand, this office doesn't have, it's not a budget that's going to the Howlin' Wolf. It's not a grant that I can give to the Rebirth Brass Band. This is about raising the level of the cultural economy as a whole. Will that benefit my business as part of that? Well, yeah, it should benefit every business as part of that. That's the goal of doing the whole thing. So at any point, if there is a conflict, we have city attorneys, we have all these folks behind me. I'll recuse myself in a heartbeat if there's any appearance of impropriety. This is too important for it to be about any one thing or one person. This is about the entire city as a whole, and I think as everybody begins to embrace that, as I go on the listening tour and listen to the things that are going on within the community, it'll become readily apparent. This isn't about I've got access to this funds and I can put it in my pocket. This is literally about getting more money in everybody's pocket. One of the things we're also doing is working on performing rights organization reform. This is mailbox money that goes into musicians' pockets. That's a huge thing. And it's not just a presence that's happening here locally. It's a presence that's going to happen on a nationwide level. We are, and we keep saying this, a world-class city. This is something we can lead on, that we are leading on. And so I've been speaking to nighttime directors all across the country and all across the world, and they love what we're doing, the way that this office is set up, the leadership that's gotten it to this point. it will not be a conflict. I can assure you of that.
Thank you, Howard.
Any more topics? Is Travis back? I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Kermit, can I ask you a question? I know that you're not a big topic, but
you
have a bar that goes late night. How important is it for just not as an ambassador of the city, but as a bar owner to have access to somebody at 3 or 4 in the morning when obviously City Hall is closed, but you now have a line to Howie or people if you have a complaint at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning?
Yeah. I'm normally closed at 11.
Oh.
But I know Howie personally, so I'll just call Howie any given time for anything. Like, give me a gig, Howie, so, stuff like that. But, I'm just quite sure it's going to be a great help, man. I mean, it can't do nothing but help, and it only could do good. We live in the best city in the world.
We need to embrace that and really understand that. How we're looked upon around the world. That's the city of New Orleans. And as the mayor of the city of New Orleans, I'm absolutely the best ambassador for this city. Any mayor is, but I'm mayor right now. We're gonna do everything that we can to preserve, protect, uplift, and serve the cultural community of the city of New Orleans. Any other questions? Melissa. Well, first of all, I think, one, we're creating force multipliers in this space, especially being able to access city government after hours. So, one, I would say a permit, you go to safety and permits directly. If there's any issue with that, of course, you can reach out to Howie, but Howie doesn't do permitting. But he can absolutely, as one of my things with all of my folks, we share information. We have to work together to troubleshoot and get things done. So there will always be, you know, a way that we can, one, you can go straight, and you can also circle the wagons if you need to get something done. Anything to add on that, Howie?
So we're still working on the processes, and we're actually using a lot of the best practices for folks that have been doing this for a while. In particular, Kate Becker out of Seattle, she's kind of the godmother of this. And as I learn and talk more about how we deal with some of these issues, every city deals with it very differently. The fact that our cultural economy is so all-encompassing of everything that we do, we're gonna have to come up with new and better practices in conjunction with that. But to answer your question, are you gonna call it at 3 o'clock in the morning because this is going on? I think we're looking at new ways to deal with that period. I think it's about mediation. It's about figuring out the issues before it becomes an issue at 3 o'clock in the morning. There's a program out of New York called MEND that Ariel Pollitz has put into place that we're gonna use a lot of those pieces in creating a policy like that here, where we can get business owners and neighbors and anybody that's in conflict before it becomes an issue, before it goes through the long process of going through enforcement. We're gonna take some of that out and turn it into a positive rather than letting it sit there and linger.
Being more proactive.
Being proactive, yep. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thank you all.
Thank you all.
Kermit's gonna play. I was just about to say.
One more idea.
Wait, we do. She can't. Melissa can't see you.
Sure.
No, you're fine.
No, I'm just wondering. You've been out in the community now, talking to people about this new position in this new office. What is one of the biggest needs that you see as a priority stepping into this?
So for this office. Strangely enough, it's a little bit of everything from each community, because I've been a part of the music community here for 25 years. Musicians want more money, but they also want stability that comes with that. I think it's more than anything, it's quality of life. And we talk about crime. What can we do? I'm not a police officer, and this office is not going to be a policing agency. But what we can do is find ways to make things easier for the NOPD. Easier for the community. So when we're sitting there talking about the communities, one of the things we're talking about is years ago, you went to a place in the French Quarter and you had a glass bottle, you had to put it in a go cup. Everybody did it, but that's now becoming more and more of an issue. Places were shut down. So I think reinstituting policies that were effective in different districts, figuring out exactly what they need. I don't think there's gonna be one overarching theme. I think it's more about the quality of life and about what we can do to elevate that. Again, world-class city that's going to lead on all of these issues. It's
police departments all over the world come to look at us and how we deal with Mardi Gras and how we deal with crowds. I truly believe that we're going to be leading the way in that when it comes to the nighttime cultural economy. So we've actually already started that process, and we have a really good relationship with the NOPD, but the goal will be on each shift to have a contact person, a desk sergeant, somebody rank, so that when there is an issue going on that's related to the nighttime economy, that we can deal with it directly. There is going to be no one-size-fits-all, but I think having better conversations. The cultural economy is part of the solution to some of the issues we're having when it comes to crime, when it comes to litter, when it comes to quality of life. These taverns, bars, music clubs, restaurants, hotels, they're all going to be partners in getting the city back to where we need it to be. It's not going to be about pointing fingers. It's going to be about figuring out solutions.
Okay. Did I miss anyone? Okay. Perfect segue. Yeah. Take us away, Carmen. All aboard.